over 60 years, the ARC Alliance has been in your community, providing support and services for families and individuals with special needs. From birth through life, the ARC Alliance team of experts and specialists are here to find solutions to your needs.
For years, we felt alone as we take care of our son. The ARC Alliance support team brings compassion and understanding to our family and provides hands-on solutions.
The ARC Alliance, we're here to help you today. For more information, call 610-265-4700 or visit thearcalliance.org.
Hello. Welcome to our show, ARC Alliance, Building Bridges in the Community. My name is Julie Agnew, and I am a board member with the ARC Alliance Advocacy Services. Today, we have our guest, Paul Stengle, who is the CEO of the ARC Alliance. Welcome, Paul.
Welcome.
Can you begin by telling us about the ARC Alliance?
Yes, the ARC Alliance was started in 1951 by parents of children with disability. They were an advocacy group and a service provider. Since that year time, we have grown over the years and now provide a number of different services. We provide guardianship services for people who are unable to make decisions on everyday life and need support. We provide early intervention to babies and infants, birth through three, to help their family do things with their child that diminishes any delays that their child may have. We provide case management where we see that people get the services they need, see that the services are quality see that clients can participate and make choices concerning the services that they receive.
Okay. I understand that the ARC Alliance has taken the position that rates for early intervention services need to increase. Why do you feel that way?
Well, our last increase in early intervention rates were about 11 years ago. The inflationary index went up over 20% in the last 11 years, and we are required to have professional licensed and certified staff, such as physical therapist, occupational therapist, speech therapist, and certified special ed teachers to provide the coaching to families in the community. And there have been a tremendous increase in the need for professionals that, like the ones we hire, and the cost for those professionals continue to grow. Healthcare has gone up about 20% a year over the last 11 years, and it's becoming extremely difficult to recruit the professional staff that we need because we have not received an increase in 11 years. And at this point, I think it's beginning to affect the quality of services that we can deliver. And the ARC Alliance is unwilling to provide services that are not of the highest quality. So we are going to be working with the legislature once the governor's budget comes out in February to hopefully get an increase after 11 years. I'm pleased to report that Governor Wolf has indicated that he will be asking for a cost of living increase for early intervention this year. We wait with great anticipation to see that he fulfills his commitment.
In 2005, the Supreme Court in the United States determined that the burden of proof to show that a child is not being educated properly falls on the plaintiff, which most times is the parent. You're advocating that the burden of proof should shift back to the state. Why are you asking for this change?
Mainly because it is very difficult for a parent to prove that their child is not being educated appropriately. The school districts has psychologists, attorneys, teachers, and other professionals that are more capable of substantiating the appropriateness of the education a child receives. Parents understand their child and generally know if they're not making adequate progress. But again, if you go into a due process hearing unrepresentative, it's almost impossible to win the due process. So you need to hire an attorney. And attorney fees can range from $100 to $400 an hour. Many attorneys asked initially for a $5,000 upfront deposit. And if you're a single mom with a child with special needs, it is virtually impossible to have the resources it needs to proceed with a due process. Also, when the burden of proof is upon the family, they're going to have to hire experts to evaluate their child and to act as witnesses in the hearing to substantiate that the child is not being educated appropriately. And again, this can cost thousands of dollars. So virtually, when you put the due process, in due process, you put the burden of proof on the family, you're really discriminating against poor and low-income families. They cannot get the access to a due process system because they can't afford it and are unable to represent and substantiate the appropriateness of the education their children is receiving. In 2005, as you indicated, the Supreme Court said that the burden of proof is upon the plaintiff, and that's generally how all legal action is. However, they also said that if the state decides to place the burden on the school district, then they could do that and the school district would have the burden of proof. Until 2005 in Pennsylvania, indeed the school district had the burden of proof. The school districts are generally opposed to having more responsibility, although they get paid fairly well for children who are receiving special education. And I personally think it's very reasonable and appropriate if a parent asks and files for a hearing that they go into the hearing and prove and substantiate the appropriateness of the education. Again, if the school district has the burden, if the parent files, the hearing officers, who are a very qualified individual, can ask the school district questions and substantiate whether the school district is or is not providing an appropriate education. So by shifting the burden to the school district, you're basically guaranteeing the rights for due process to all families, including low-income families. And when I say low-income families, there are many due processes that cost $10,000, $30,000, $40,000 or more dollars, and it is extremely or impossible for low-income families to have that much money to fund the attorneys to do the hearing. And again, you also have to hire expert witnesses and get secondary evaluations to substantiate the fact that the school district is not providing appropriate education. And again, this bill is about giving access for all parents to a due process hearing to see that their child is being educated appropriately.
So as a parent, if I feel that my child is not being educated properly, I would need to hire a lawyer and pay $7,000 for a retainer. I would need to hire experts, and I would need to take on the school district and take time off of work for hearings in order to get my child what he or she needs?
Yes, and I know of a case of two professionals who were well-educated and great advocates, master degree or above for both of the parents, who the school district stopped providing the services in the IEP because they indicated that they didn't need the services, took the case for a hearing, ended up spending close to $250,000 on attorney fees and about $12,000 for expert witnesses, missed 13 days of work because of the hearings. When they received the decision from the hearing officer, the hearing officer found for the parents. In fact, indicated that the school district was retaliating against the parents. And the school district appealed it, so it ended up in federal court, at which time, through an arbitrator, it was settled. But again, this family got a second mortgage and went through the process. I will tell you that if you file for a due process hearing and you're successful and get a decision in your favor, the attorney fees need to be picked up by the school district. Which is a good thing, because many times if the school district is not doing or providing the appropriate education, they will settle the case, and most requests for hearing end up in settlement. But again, if you have to go through the process, it can cost thousands of dollars to do that. I will tell you that the $250,000 law fee is not common. Generally, cases settle and don't go to hearing, and even if they go to hearing, they're relatively short and don't require 13 days of hearing.
Okay. Are there other states that are like Pennsylvania? Do other states require that the burden be on the school district, or are other states asking that the parents or the plaintiffs provide the burden?
Yes, progressive states like West Virginia, New Jersey, Maryland, Delaware, and New York have put the burden of proof on the school district, as the Supreme Court indicated that they should. It's very disappointing that Pennsylvania does not put the burden of proof on school districts, because through litigation in the early 70s, we were the first state that mandated special education for students that needed special education, and also mandated education for all students. So for us not to have passed it in virtually all of our neighboring states, requiring the school district to have the burden is very disappointing. And again, I hope the legislature will change that. It's pretty simple legislation, and we hope that this year we will get it passed.
Okay. The ARC Alliance provides guardianship services for approximately 150 individuals. Your position is that guardianship services should be state funded, and that the reimbursement for individuals who have guardians and are residing in nursing homes should also increase. Why do you feel that way?
We become guardians for a lot of individuals who have no assets. So we're required to do their services free. And we also, if you're in a nursing home and you meet certain standards and have no assets, we are able to collect $100 a month for our guardianship services. The $100 rate was set by the Department of Human Services in 1988, and it cost us an average of $250 a month to provide guardianship services. So if we have someone in a nursing home, we have to raise approximately $150 a month to provide guardianship services for them. And we think the rate should go up, and it shouldn't be 40 years before you see a rate increase. For people in the community, who have no assets, we are required to provide the services free and then have to generate $250 a month to cover the cost of the guardianship services. And we find that very disconcerting, because if you place someone in a nursing home, you get paid, and if you don't place them in a nursing home, you don't get paid. And it's certainly an economic incentive to put people in nursing homes. And I can tell you, if you're guarding someone in a nursing home, it's a lot easier to provide supports than if you have someone in the community. If you have someone in the community, you've got to make sure that they have the support services they need. You've got to make sure they're paying their rent, that they're getting their food, that they're seeing the doctor. And we think the system is crazy. It's interestingly, if you're a lawyer and you represent someone, the courts will pay you. But if you're not a lawyer, they won't pay you. So we think that they should provide, the state should fund the courts to provide reimbursement for guardians. And we also think there should be an economic incentive to keep people in the community, and that any incentive to institutionalize people should be done away with.
How do you find services for people in the community when you're a guardian?
Well, we're very good at it. We have a long experience of providing service coordination, which does get funded to provide supports. So we're very able to know what services are available, whether it be railroad benefits or VA benefits or state services. We also, as I indicated, have a large commitment to keep people in the least restrictive environment, and we work very well in keeping people in the community. It is and can be a very time-consuming job. Usually when we get many of our referrals, people are in crisis. That's why they are found to be incompetent, because they've made decisions to put them in crisis. And we're very good at working at that. We also have concerns that many people get appointed guardians who don't need guardians. And we have gone into court and said, we want you to certify this person competent because they're capable. Years ago, the ARC Alliance and other ARCs advocated very strongly to get limited guardianships so that individuals would not be found incompetent in all areas, but could be found in very specific areas. For example, someone cannot manage their money, you can have a guardian appointed to you, and they can be just responsible for your finances. There are also other ways to avoid guardianships, such as repayee and power of attorney. They can give people assistance without taking away their rights. They get removed as guardianship. And about the cost, recently the Supreme Court has decided to improve the guardianship situation, and we are very happy that they're doing that. Until recently, the only qualifications you had to be is over 18. You could have a criminal record, you could have no training. Now, the Supreme Court is really required, if you have so many people under guardianship, I think it's three, that you have to be certified by the National Guardianship Association. We have been seeing that our guardianships are certified for years, and we are very happy that there will be these standards of quality that the Supreme Court has demanded. There is also a new reporting system, where across the state, if you're a guardian, you'll have to report online information about the individual who needs guardianship services. And again, that standardization, we think, is a good idea. Frankly, Montgomery County and Berks County and Bucks County do a fabulous job in the courts with guardianship. But more rural counties have not reviewed annual reports or seen that there was appropriate management of money, and I think the computer system is going to improve the quality of guardianship that is offered in Pennsylvania.
Paul, the ARC Alliance is advocating for rate increases in the state's budget for community programs. Can you give us a little history about how those rates have been set for the community programs?
Yes, that's been a long and arduous process. In the 70s and 80s, individuals were program funded. So you would open up a group home and you would receive so much per year to provide services. If at the end of the year, which happened a lot of the times, you were in a deficit position, you could go back to the county and say, we are running a deficit, and if they had additional money, they would fund you. Each county negotiated with providers on what the annual cost would be, and depending on how much of a crisis the county was in opening the facility and how good the provider was a negotiator, some providers got very good annual rates and other providers got less than they needed. Also, the longer you operated a facility, the more you were likely to run a deficit because there were not always cost of living increases, and when there were cost of living increases, they were far less than what the providers generally needed. The state has done a remarkable job of trying to set fair rates, and they started in the late 80s and 90s to have a daily per diem rate or a hourly per diem rate or a 15-minute per diem rate, depending on what the service was being delivered. And again, the rates vary dramatically county by county, and again, from provider to providers. Because of pressure from the federal government, who helps fund a lot of our programs, eventually per diem rates were set across programs. So if you had a workshop in Philadelphia or a workshop in Montgomery County, you got paid on a per diem of every 15 minutes, you got an X amount of dollars, and it was consistent throughout the region that you were in. The difficulty was that a lot of these rates were too low and some of the rates were a little high, and we are seeing significant problems with some of the rates that were set last year, and particularly habilitation rates for persons with intellectual developmental disability and autism are too low, and providers are unable to provide the services at the rates that the state is willing to reimburse for. And again, it was very difficult with a wide range of rates for the state to figure out what a service should or should not cost. And again, it was a good decision, and they've done a pretty remarkable job across the board. But in certain areas, they are still not adequate. And so we hope this year that there will be an increase in the budget so the habilitation rates can be at a level that providers can operate successfully. I can tell you habilitation rates are very important to us because we would prefer for a family member to stay with a family member with disabilities, and it's one of the least expensive forms of support. When you put someone in a group home, the rates are much higher, and if you put someone in an institution, they're astronomic. So funding habilitation rates, we believe, will be cost effective in the long term, beneficial to the state. There was a substantial increase last year in the Office of Developmental Programs to offset some of this rate setting and make it equitable, but they still have some distance to go, and we're hopeful for a increase this year so that the rates can be made fair and equitable.
What is your position on Pennsylvania addressing the waiting list?
We have been an advocate for adequate funding to provide services to everyone on the emergency waiting list. Presently, there are 5,000 individuals who are on the emergency waiting list in Pennsylvania. That means they need services today, and that's a staggering number. The state legislature and the governor has been very supportive of the waiting list, and we hope that there's additional funding, as there has been for many years, to serve the people on the waiting list.
How about direct support professional wages?
We are very pleased with discussions of increasing the minimum wage. We are happy that the economy is doing well and that there is low unemployment. But if we're going to increase the minimum wage and with this economy, we're going to need to provide additional funding for community programs across the board, from group homes to in-home services. Most entry-level positions in group homes get around $11 to $12 an hour. We are having a tremendous problem recruiting staff who are willing to work in group homes and other community programs. And it is crucial that we address this labor shortage and provide more funding for the direct care workers. Our administration and CEOs in many cases are underpaid, but that's not where we want to see the funding. We want to see the funding go to those individuals who are working directly with people with developmental disabilities.
Thank you for joining us today, Mr. Stengle. If you have any questions about anything that we presented today, or any questions about services for your family member, please feel free to contact Mr. Stengle at 484-868-0443.
For over 60 years, the ARC Alliance has been in your community, providing support and services for families and individuals with special needs. From birth through life, the ARC Alliance team of experts and specialists are here to find solutions to your needs.
For years, we felt alone as we take care of our son. The ARC Alliance support team brings compassion and understanding to our family and provides hands-on solutions.
The ARC Alliance, we're here to help you today. For more information, call 610-265-4700 or visit thearcalliance.org.